Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and in this video, we will be discussing some of the basic terminology of innervation, as this will be a consistent topic of discussion in anatomy throughout the year, and you'll see it come up in many of your clinical lectures as well. So let's start building that foundation, and we can go from there. So first and foremost, we need to focus on just the terms afferent and efferent and getting those down. And then we'll move more into distinguishing between the different types of afferent and efferent fibers and what their functions are. So afferent and efferent, two words that sound pretty darn similar, but have some fairly significant differences. So we'll start with afferent. Afferent neurons, so we have the A here, afferent neurons will carry sensory information into the brain or spinal cord, so aka the central nervous system. And it's going to carry this information through cranial and spinal nerves from either a sense organ, like the eyes or the nasal mucosa, or sensory receptors from various parts of the skin, or parts of the body, particularly we talk about the skin. You can kind of see, you know, you have information from the skin being sent along, say, a spinal nerve and making its way to the central nervous system. So for our purposes, when speaking of innervation, afferent will be synonymous with sensory innervation. And so it will take information like we have here, say, from the skin, as you can see in this lovely cartoonish image, or it could be from a muscle or another organ and bring it back to the central nervous system for integration to occur. Efferent neurons, here with the E, will carry information from the central nervous system. As you can kind of see here, it was integrated here. Now it's going to carry that information from the central nervous system to an effector, such as a muscle or a gland, and something will happen, like a muscle contraction or a glandular secretion. Again, for our purposes, efferent will be synonymous, when we're talking about innervation, will be synonymous with motor, and you will definitely hear them used interchangeably. So you may hear me say efferent, you may hear me say motor, so be aware that those two terms are going to be synonymous when we're talking innervation. Two other terms I want to cover before we start breaking down nerve fiber types are somatic and visceral. And you can have somatic afferent and efferent fibers, as well as visceral afferent and efferent fibers. So for somatic, this means of the body, which I must admit is a bit vague. Isn't everything kind of the body? But what we're really meaning here is something that's more conscious, particularly with these structures, than say what is going on with some of your deeper organs or viscera, but it's not always conscious. This will involve skeletal muscle, as well as sensory receptors of the skin, or sensory receptors within skeletal muscles and joints. And oftentimes, the special sensory receptors are lumped into this category, but we will discuss them separately because, as their name suggests, they are special. Then we also have visceral. Visceral is associated with viscera. That kind of goes together, right? Viscera means organs, particularly when we're talking about the hollow organs. You have those, I kind of think of those associated with GI, or the gastrointestinal tract. It can be part of some of the reproductive organs. But smooth muscle is also going to be considered when we're talking visceral. And glands are going to be considered visceral. So let's combine these terms that we just learned to get the 4 to 5 main categories of nerve fibers, starting with a very clinically important category that doesn't get as much airtime typically because it is afferent and not directly creating an effect. And these will be the somatic afferent fibers. And you may hear these fibers referred to as general somatic afferent or GSA. I put these in italics, and you'll see italics in a few other areas throughout this video. I put these here just to expose you to these terms, but we won't use these here at U of M But be aware that if you're looking at a textbook, you may see this terminology. It's very dependent on what type of discipline you're talking about as to what we use here. But we're going with somatic afferent fibers. And what these fibers will do will send information regarding sensation from the skin back to the central nervous system. For certain ones of these fibers, this information can include signals indicating pain associated with the skin, touch, pressure, temperature. And there are these awesomely amazing maps called dermatome maps that depict the areas of the skin that are afferently innervated by a single cranial nerve or a single spinal nerve. Right here, this side, I'm going to kind of draw this. This side over here is going to be the dermatome map. This over here is a peripheral nerve map. So let's focus on this area for a second. These maps are created based on clinical studies of lesions of specific nerves and what happened when those areas were, or those nerves were directly affected. So what area lost sensation if there was a lesion to a specific spinal nerve or a specific cranial nerve? So if you have lack of sensory innervation, say to kind of this general area right here, this would be a possible indication that the spinal nerves L2 or L3 are damaged. So do not by any means try to memorize these maps right now. This is solely here for illustration of a concept. We will touch on a few of these areas throughout the year and really focus more when we get to neurology and the musculoskeletal content later on in this year. But this is a clinically important kind of map that could give you some indication of specific nerve damage. Somatic afferent fibers don't just innervate the skin, but also skeletal muscle and their tendons and how they are affecting joints. So if you've ever heard the term proprioception, this is talked quite a bit less in regards to sensory innervation, but is very important in terms of providing sensory information regarding the positioning of a joint or say stretch or overstretch of a skeletal muscle without visual input. So this will give you an idea. I always say kind of put your hand behind your back and start kind of moving your fingers kind of back and forth. You know that's happening, right? Without actually seeing it, you're kind of feeling it. That's going to be more that proprioception. So when we talk about muscles, we usually think efferent or what is causing a contraction, but there will also be afferent fibers associated for this proprioceptive function. Visceral afferent fibers will convey information from hollow organs and blood vessels back to the central nervous system, or the CNS. So the type of information we are talking about include pain or, say, subconscious visceral reflex information like blood pressure levels or the over-distension or overextension of an organ. And we're typically not as conscious of these, but we certainly can be, and they are much more vaguely localized, so not what we had, say, with that pretty set dermatomal map that we saw for the somatic afferents. So just because we're not as conscious, even though we can be some, you certainly do still have sensation associated with these structures. Lastly, in regards to afferents, there will be special afferent, or you are more likely, actually, and I don't have this in italics because you will hear this very often by us as well, you will hear special sensory fibers. And these will be associated with certain cranial nerves. You're seeing some of the cranial nerves here. We'll spend some time learning these a little bit later on. But certain cranial nerves will have special sensory fibers, and these are associated with what we think of as our special senses. So things such as smell, sight, hearing, balance or equilibrium, and taste. Now on to the efferent fibers. So we've back to the E here. And we'll start with somatic efferent fibers. These are going to transmit impulses to skeletal muscle. And some form of contraction or relaxation of the muscle will occur due to that. And so you're having from a component of the central nervous system, and it's going to be more over here. This would be the somatic over on this side. So you'll have from the central nervous system, you'll have an axon, it will be associated directly with that muscle, and some type of effect will occur. These are the muscles that we are typically consciously aware of that will move the musculoskeletal system. So again, kind of really focus on the fact that we're talking skeletal muscle here. And when we're discussing muscles throughout the year, we will often talk about what innervates that muscle and ask you to memorize that and ask you to know what innervates that muscle. And usually what we're getting at is either that cranial nerve or the spinal nerve that will be sending the efferent fibers to that muscle, allowing it to contract or relax. But keep in mind, most named nerves will have both afferent and efferent fibers wrapped up in its connective tissue. So it will have efferent fibers that will play a role in terms of contraction, and it will have those afferent fibers associated with the proprioception of that muscle. Visceral efferent fibers are fun too and are associated generally with the autonomic nervous system. These fibers will transmit impulses from the central nervous system. It will have a kind of intermediate neuron associated with it, where you'll have some synapse occurring before it gets to its target effector. And we'll talk a little bit more about this in the next session. But this will transmit impulses from the central nervous system and eventually will make its way to the target effectors, which when we're talking about the visceral efferents, this will either be smooth muscle, which are typically unconsciously controlled, or glands. And so for a gland, the effect will either be increasing or decreasing secretion, and smooth muscle will either be contraction or relaxation of that smooth muscle. All right, we have made it to our trusty review slide, which as always we recommend you use for your studying. You know, I would kind of save these and refer to them throughout the year. They can be helpful in that way. And it's really getting down to some of our biggest picture concepts from this learning objective. Please always feel free to reach out to myself or any of my anatomy colleagues with any questions you may have. Thank you for your time and attention, and have a great rest of your day.